Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. In verse number 25, it says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said unto him, What is written in the law? How readest thou? And he answering said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, Thou hast answered right, this do, and thou shalt live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, And who is my neighbor? See, he said, all right, I can do that, but who is it that I'm supposed to do this for? What's this character I'm supposed to love anyway? I hope it's somebody I like. And Jesus answered. So Jesus feeds off of the self-righteousness of this man. And the selective love or compassion that he might exhibit. And he goes into the story here of the Good Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise, a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in wine, oil and wine, and set him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence, and gave them to the host, and said unto him, Take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which now of these three thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, He that showed mercy on him. Then said Jesus unto him, Go and do thou likewise. Isn't it amazing how and you almost lose this because he's talking about these three individuals. He's talking about this thief. He's talking to the crowd there. But notice in between verse 29 when it says, But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, And who is my neighbor? After he tells this whole story, look at verse number 7. And he said, Do you wonder who the he is there? It's the he that was spoken of back in verse number 29. It's that guy. He said, he that showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said unto him, Go and do thou likewise. You see, in this man's mind, in order to justify himself, he was willing to maybe love this neighbor as himself. But he just wanted to be sure of who the neighbor was. And he thought, well, a neighbor would be somebody that you highly respect. A neighbor might be somebody that you totally agree with. A neighbor might be somebody that you have much in common with. But Jesus points out here, no, this particular neighbor is a Samaritan. We don't like Samaritans. Yeah, but he's the neighbor. And so you go and do thou likewise. We're not told what he did. We hear of stories where individuals came. We know of the rich young ruler that had been told to go and sell his possessions and come and follow him. And then it says that he went away sorrowing. because he had many possessions. He just kind of went away. And that was the end of it. We don't know what this man did. I don't know if he wanted a Samaritan as a neighbor, or if he would think of a Samaritan as a neighbor. But as we look at this story here, I just want to kind of go over it a little bit. I'm not going to preach any points or anything like this. It's just something that's been kind of been in my head and running through my heart for a while here. Notice it says that a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. You see, Jerusalem is about 2,600 feet above sea level. Matter of fact, we refer to it as Mount Zion. It's a high place. And he goes down, it says, he went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Jericho is the lowest city on earth. You can't get much lower than Jericho. Oh, sure, the lowest point on earth is the Dead Sea, which is not that far away. And even beyond that, the lowest place in America is Death Valley. People aren't all that excited about those low places. But here we see that this individual, a certain man, went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. You know, I can't help but think that this individual here, he sounds an awful lot like maybe somebody like the Lord Jesus Christ. Sounds an awful lot like him, like he left a high and lofty place like the heavenly Jerusalem. And he came down here and he fell among thieves. Because you know who the thieves are? Jesus said in John chapter 10, anybody that would want to climb up to God some other way, he said he's a robber and he's a thief. See, we go God's way. And so he fell among thieves, stripped him of his raiment. Yeah, they did that, didn't they? And wounded him. They surely did wound him. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes, we're healed. We're healed. Leaving him half dead. Now, that's I can see how that would relate. As a matter of fact, I see this individual in that situation. I see him as Jesus, but we're going to see somebody else that shows up like Jesus in this as well. Because, you know, this really is a description of man. We're about as low as you can get, you know. When we fell from a high and lofty position. We were created in the image of God. And yet we fell from that. And having fallen and just being a mess in our own lives, I'm glad that even though it says here we're half dead, and mankind, I know, I'm not going to get theologically picky here. I know we're a tripartite being, body, soul, and spirit. But if you'll entertain my thinking here a little bit, all of us are half dead. So, oh no, we're really a third dead. Well, you know, we're half dead. You see, physically speaking, we're all walking around and just fine, right? We've got life. But spiritually speaking, mankind is dead. Left half dead. And in that place, which is really where all of us are, we're all just a bunch of beggars, lying around in a desperate situation, half dead, looking for someone, something to come along and help us. Well, And by chance, there is help. There is help available to lost sinners. And, well, let's see how they show up here. It says here that there came a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise, a Levite, when he was at the place, came, looked on him, and passed by on the other side. You see, these two characters and what we see in this passage here are some worldly philosophies. And the philosophies that we see are rather prevalent as it relates to religion and just the way in which religion deals with people. But uh, these, these individuals here, the philosophy of the thieves. We have these thieves here, and by the way, this whole area here is Jericho is a priestly city. It's been reported that there's probably about as many as 12,000 priests that were down in the city of Jericho. And this road on the road to Jericho there was notoriously overrun by thieves, because there were always people going back and forth through this region, and so there were prime pickings for folks. So the thieves knew that. But what's the philosophy of a thief? I'll tell you what it is. The philosophy of a thief is what's yours is mine. They don't care about you. They don't care how hard you work for it. They don't care what happens when you don't have it anymore. All they know is, I want what you've got. What yours is mine. That's their philosophy. But then we have the philosophy here of the priest and the Levite. And the priest and the Levite, that philosophy, and it's the philosophy of religion, what's mine is mine. What's mine is mine. You see, the priest and the Levite, these two individuals here, if we just kind of take a second to go back and think about religion in Judaism, both of these are important characters in the life of Israel. The priest, these are all the sons that come through Levi. Levi is a special tribe. Levi is a special individual. Initially, God had kind of made it so that for Israel, all the firstborns would be the priests of the family. And probably determined that that wasn't going to work out well, so he chose one tribe specifically to be the priestly tribe. And that tribe was the tribe of Levi. But it was not all the individuals in the tribe of Levi that were the priests. As a matter of fact, Levi had three sons, Gershom, and Kohath, and Merari. And those three, out of those three, God instituted their workings. And so for Gershom, he took care of the coverings and the curtains and the cords. The responsibility of that tribe was to take care of those things as it pertained to the tabernacle. Merari, on the other hand, took care of the boards and the sockets and the pillars and the bars, had that responsibility. But it was Kohath, the Kohathites. They are the ones that were in charge of the sanctuary. They were the ones that were responsible for the holy items, the ark and the table of showbread, all of those special things. But even though all of these three sons of Levi had their religious involvement, there was only one, and it was of the sons of Kohath. And that's where you find Moses and Aaron. And of course, then their sons, Nadab and Abihu and Eleazar and Ithamar, those were the priests. They were the special group of the tribe of Israel. So with that said, when we see these here, here's Jesus telling a story. He's trying to convey a message to this man who is no doubt very self-righteous, very picky about who he's going to constitute to be his neighbor. And so, in the mind, think about this, in the mind of these individuals that are standing there, in the mind of this man that he's trying to reach, in the mind of anyone standing around and listening to Jesus tell this story, they're thinking, as soon as Jesus said, here we had this character, and this character's in the ditch, and he's stripped of his raiment. And by the way, if he's stripped of his raiment, then you don't know whether he's a good man or a bad man, or because he doesn't have a three-piece suit on. If he did, you could say, oh, I better help him. But if he looked like a little shabby and looked like a bum, you'd say, ooh, I don't want to touch him. But he's stripped of his raiment. You know, when you think about it, folks, when we're stripped of our raiment, we all look the same. Yeah, we do. There's no respect of persons with God. And so they look, and as Jesus is telling the story, As soon as he tells the story about this poor individual that's laying in the ditch, no doubt it must raise at least a curiosity factor to everyone that's listening. All right, okay, so we got this character over here. And then he says, and along comes a priest and a Levite. And I know what's crossing their mind right there. They say, oh, they'll help them because they're religious, right? They're going to help them. And so who's the first one that we see? He comes along here and it says there was a priest. See, a special group, the elite group, the ones who were responsible for the most intricate details, the only ones that could actually go into the holy place. Oh, they'll help. They'll help, won't they? It's kind of like when you think of an individual, a lost person, male or female, it makes no difference. A lost person, you see their condition, you see that they need help, and you think, well, religion will help out, won't it? Well, what did religion do? What did the priest do? It says quite plainly there, it says that he, by chance, there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. He said, oh, well, you're not like me. Oh, look how nasty and disgusting you are. You must be a terrible person to be in this situation. I better not get close to you. There's no telling what I might get. I'm very clean. I'm very sanctified. I don't want to be defiled by touching the likes of you. So he crosses over to the other side. Isn't it amazing how religion always wants to keep itself distant? It's almost like the attitude of the religionist is, if you want what I got, then you come and get it. Well, it says, and likewise, a Levite. Now, that's the special tribe. In both instances here, there's an expectation that both of these characters, anyone listening to this story is going to assume that either the Levite or the priest are going to assist this man. And we might think the same thing, wouldn't you? Jesus is setting them up. It's a fine spectacle to see religion not being able to help, but being unwilling to help. But a certain Samaritan. Now you have to know something about Samaritans. Samaritans are half-breeds. Samaritans are not purebred Jews. They've been going back centuries ago. You deal with some of the tribes there, particularly the tribe of Dan, up in the northern tribes, and they began to mix in with the heathens. So, yes, they've got some Jewish roots, but they've got some heathen roots too. And that's why you find the statement made over and over again in the New Testament. Jesus uses the Samaritans in a number of ways in order to just kind of rub the fur the wrong way on Jews, because they hated him, because they weren't like us. Well, he's not going to help. He won't help him. I mean, they're good for nothing. Oh, really? He says here, as he journeyed, he came where he was, unlike the priest and the Levite, went right over to where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion on him. He just cared. He didn't know who he was. He didn't know if he was a Samaritan or a full-blooded Jew. He didn't know if he was the mayor of the city. He didn't know if he was a bum. All he knew was, here's an individual half dead, beaten to a pulp, lying in the gutter. Somebody ought to help him. Now you can imagine, you're standing around and you're listening to this story. Jesus telling the story. It says he went to him and bound up his wounds, bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, set him on his own beast, Oh, there's no telling what he got on the seat. I mean, he took this thing, flea infested, whatever this mutt is, and he put him on his own beast. Oh, we'll have to have this thing detailed. And he brought him to an inn. I wonder what kind of inn he brought him to. The Fleabag Hotel? I don't know which, I don't know what hotel he brought him to. What inn he brought him to, but he brought him to one, and to the point where he said, take care of him. He took care of him. He didn't pass it off to somebody else. He didn't say, I found this wretch on the side of the road. He took responsibility, had compassion on him, took him up, put him on his own beast, brought him to an inn, took care of him. It appears at least spent the night with him. And then when it was all over on the morrow, that's what it says, so next day, on the morrow when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said unto him, take care of him. He was not willing to be done with him. He said, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. All these people standing around listening to this story. Do you believe this? You mean to tell me some stinking Samaritan did this? Would a Samaritan ever do that? I mean, I would expect that from the priest and the Levite, but not a Samaritan. Who would do such a thing? Well, let me see. Which now of these 3 thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? Was it A, the priest? B, multiple choice here, folks. B, the Levite, or C, the nasty, disgusting Samaritan? He that showed mercy on him? Would it be him? Could it be him? Oh, tell me it's not him. Please tell me that my religion is the only thing that can help. Maybe if we went back and if we chased the priest and the Levite down and we told them, there's a Samaritan back there doing your job, they would come back. Jesus, don't tell me. Don't tell me that religion, because this is exactly what Jesus is trying to get at here. Your self-righteous religionists, they won't help. They won't help. They don't want to help. They'll just walk on the other side and go, oh, sorry. Sorry. Too bad for you, bud. I'll call 911. Maybe. And along comes this nasty Samaritan. Look at this. Do you think he had anything to do? Think he was busy? Maybe he had a job, had a family? Think he had some of the same concerns? Do you think he might have, you know, been all cleaned up himself? I believe he probably was. The only difference is that one had compassion. The one looked beyond the situation. The one looked beyond the obvious and said, well, it doesn't matter who he is. It doesn't matter what he's done. It doesn't matter. All that matters is somebody needs to help him. Then said Jesus unto him, go and do thou likewise. Now, With all that said here tonight, I guess the point we need to make is, who is this Good Samaritan? Would you be the Good Samaritan? Well, let's see. You're a mutt. I'm a mutt. We've got no pure stock. We're nothing but a bunch of old beggars. And we see people and they have need, and are we willing to help in the need? Who is the Good Samaritan? See, this is the point that I think we all understand. Well, thank God that somebody came along and helped out. But if Jesus didn't have in his mind another spiritual lesson that he was trying to teach, he could have just said, a plumber and a bartender walked by on the other side. Because what difference would it have made what their occupation was? Who they were. He could have said a Catholic and a Jew. He could have said a Mormon and a Jehovah's Witness. He could have said an Italian and a Puerto Rican. He could have said anything, but he specifically said a priest and a Levite. Not every word of God is pure, folks. He knew exactly what he was saying there. Because he wanted him to know that religion, all you want to do is follow your religion to a T. And he said, your religion overlooks the need of man. And that's what he's pointing out to him. If he were to say, well, whoever my neighbor is, I'll do it. But he didn't say that. His question was, exactly who is my neighbor? In other words, you let me know who the neighbor is, and I'll let you know whether or not I'm willing to do this. Because if it happens to be one of those, I'm out. See, the Samaritan, the Good Samaritan, remember someone came to Jesus and said, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus said, hang on there, son. Why callest thou me good? There's none good but one, that is God. Oh. You see, the Good Samaritan is none other than Jesus Christ. See, he's the one that when he sees the need, it doesn't matter who it is, he addresses the need. And he doesn't just say some kind words. He's willing to reach down and take us up and take us and bring us and carry us and care for us and provide for us and say, and if you need anything down the road, I'll do that too. That's the Good Samaritan. Religion, we'll be praying for you. And when you get better, our church is over there. You come and bring your wallet, and we'll be your neighbor.